Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. And welcome to a management lecture series. Let me start again by thanking Mitch Snyder and First Interstate for their continued support for management lecture series. Without their support, we would not be able to bring this program. Tonight's presenter is from a global industrial firm that's based in this area. Tonight I'm going to introduce Frank McGorty from De Nora Tech. De Nora Tech is the new name for a local company, ELTECH Systems Corporation. You may recognize the large pink building in Chardon, or you may know of the research operations they have in Fairport Harbor. De Nora Tech is a division of Industrie De Nora. It was purchased in 2005, and the name from ELTECH was changed to De Nora Tech. Industrie De Nora is a multinational organization based in Italy with manufacturing and other major operations worldwide, not only in Italy, but here in the United States, in Germany, Brazil, China, Singapore, India, Japan, and many others. De Nora is a world leader in innovative electrochemical technologies and energy-saving and environmentally friendly processes. When I went to the De Nora website to prepare what I was going to say, they noted that their success is driven by the following values: a shared knowledge from over 80 years of experience in the field of electrochemistry, continuous technological innovation, a focus on quality of life by promoting energy savings through environmentally focused technological development, and finally, by capitalizing on its global presence, De Nora is able to reach each customer in his or her own language in more than 60 countries worldwide. Frank McGorty is the President and Chief Operating Officer of De Nora Tech, and he serves as the Director of Global Sales for Industrie De Nora also. He's been with the company for 31 years and has held various positions, including Vice President of Sales and Marketing and Business Development, in which he was responsible for the management and strategic direction. Prior to that, he held the position of Director of Business Development, which included management responsibility for research and development. He has been instrumental in several key acquisitions of the organization and led ELTECH's team in negotiating and creating a Chinese joint venture. He also advocated a market-based approach to research and development that resulted in innovative new products. He has extensive international exposure, including administrative responsibilities for ELTECH's European branch office operations. Frank has a Bachelor of Science in Finance from the University of Connecticut at Bridgeport and an MBA from Farleigh Dickenson University. He lives in Concord with his wife Ronnie and is active at St. Gabriel's Church. He has two grown married children, but I like to say he's still waiting for grandkids. Is that right? So please, would you all join me in welcoming Frank McGorty, President and Chief Operating Officer of De Nora Tech.
Thank you. Well, first off, I'd like to thank Chris, Connie, Gary, Fred for giving us the opportunity to let you know a little bit about what we do. And I think hopefully you'll have a little better understanding of what the people in that pink building do on 44. You know, though, I wanted to start with two gentlemen. I thought about this, and I thought about a lecture series on the day before Election Day, and you're stuck with me. And you could have had one of these two guys speaking, or any number of politicians. So I have to put a disclaimer. I'm not Barack Obama. I'm not John McCain. As much as I agree with some of their messages, I do not accept their commercials, and I do not accept their robocalls. And hopefully tonight you'll feel as though our presentation will get you a little bit further into understanding us, but more importantly, you're probably avoiding as many calls as you can count on both your hands, your fingers, your toes tonight. And so hopefully you'll consider it a success that you made a decision to come here tonight. I'm going to answer some questions that I have up here. Some of them will tell you a little bit about us and what we do. There's a couple of questions I can't answer. I don't know who's going to win this election tomorrow, and I don't know when your 401ks are going to grow again. Now, not all of you in the audience, as I can see, have 401ks yet, but I know some of you do. And one of the questions, though, we are going to answer later in the presentation is, how can we get along with each other? We had an acquisition that occurred 3 years ago between an Italian company and an American company. And there's a number of challenges with that. And hopefully, I'm going to be able to give you some insight on how we've tried to answer that question. As Chris said, De Nora is a company that for 80 years has participated in the electrochemical industry. It's a big word, but basically it's a chemical technology process that you'll find a little bit later when we talk is really built on the basis of a battery. And we are really the largest supplier in the world of this kind of technology. And our core business is one that is a key component in the manufacture of chlorine, which I think we all know is a disinfectant that you see in many things, most importantly in the water we drink. And secondly, caustic soda, and that's really, Drano is my best description. I'm probably going as far as I can from a technology standpoint. It's not my background. But I know we have some technologists scattered within the audience tonight, so if you have any technical questions, I'm sure they'll be able to answer them for you. We are the largest supplier of what we call noble metal catalyst coated electrodes for the electrochemical industry. We make substrates that are coated with what we call precious metals. And the best way to describe that is, for all you ladies that have rings made of platinum, we use a derivative from platinum that is used in coating a titanium substrate. And that catalytically reacts with power and helps to make chlorine and caustic soda. Chris mentioned we have a pretty strong focus in our R&D. Hopefully many of you have seen our facility in Fairport Harbor. Actually, it doesn't look that intricate from the outside, but believe me, on the inside it is. We have a large number of many kinds of experiments that go on inside that building that allow us to understand reactions in various applications that we have throughout the world. And De Nora is committed to the R&D focus for the future. We're looking for new products and new applications. I wanted to talk a little bit about our history for a few slides, and I think it's important because this is really where we came from. The dimensionally stable anode is one that was utilized in the chloralkali industry and has been for the better part of 30-some-odd years. Gentleman by the name of Henry Beer came up with this idea of a catalytically coated electrode, and that electrode has been used in the manufacture of chlorine and caustic soda ever since. A couple of pretty smart gentlemen took that idea and they decided to license this technology through companies around the world. And as you can see on the slide here, one of those companies was De Nora out of Italy. One of the companies was Diamond Shamrock, who I know the younger folks in the audience probably aren't familiar with that, but Diamond Shamrock was a chemical company that was pretty active here, not only in Lake County, but in New York, and had a large contingent of people in both the research center over on 44 and Auburn Road that now is Reserca, and also had a huge building downtown. Diamond was a very big employer here. Our particular group was a division of Diamond Shamrock, and we were one of the licensees of the technology. The way it was decided was that it was broken up into kind of regional, global players, and each of the players had a specific area that they had licensed. And fortunately for us, the United States was a pretty lucrative area, and Diamond got that license. Some of the other licensees, this company PEL in Japan, Permascan was in the Nordic countries up in Sweden, and Heraeus was a German company. This gave us the opportunity to spread this technology worldwide. That worked well, and just as a matter of course, the DSA idea kind of was late 60s, early 70s. When this license agreement approach was taken hold, was probably in the late 70s. As we moved through the 80s, actually, the pie that I'm showing here has expanded because the world has accepted this technology. The only problem is that the piece of the U.S. became bigger, and everybody else's piece was slightly smaller. Not everybody in that circle liked that idea. And we were all licensed under a series of patents that ran out in the early 90s. When that happened, the licensees decided, well, we don't like that idea too much. So I have this picture here. And we'll just say, as you can see, the biggest players in this game were De Nora and ELTECH. The Japanese PEL had their same market share. So the two, let's say, two licensees became adversaries. And we started a process of competition around the world where they came to this market, we went to their market. These fights went on for probably a good part of 10 years. And then there was some conversation, and the decision was made that we were probably better off together than apart. And so in 2005, De Nora purchased ELTECH and has the biggest part of this share. The other thing that you should know is that De Nora also owns 50% of PEL. So we have a pretty large share of the worldwide market of this technology. So in 2005, as we've spoken, and people here are probably much more familiar with the name ELTECH than with De Nora Tech, De Nora purchased ELTECH. In 2006, they had a U.S. company, and we merged the two companies and decided to change the name. And in 2007, we became De Nora Tech. And the concept here was the best of both worlds. The worldwide De Nora name, and we still wanted to have ELTECH in the name, so the De Nora Tech came from that. The combined companies represent a fairly large share, as I mentioned, of the business, and also probably houses the most expertise and obviously the most worldwide share worldwide. So we ended up being a fairly powerful company in this space. So now that we're together and we didn't have to fight, we could put our energies in some other area. We could focus on the future, and that's what we did. And our goal was to become the leading provider of key electrochemical technologies combined with energy-saving and environmentally friendly processes. And that's our mandate today. That's what we do. We have global presence throughout the world. The nice thing about the combination between De Nora and ELTECH was the fact that ELTECH was a single location entity. We did business from right here in Chardon, Ohio, worldwide. De Nora had a slightly different approach to that and had presence in various countries worldwide. The combination of those two strategies, with this being probably the most important market in the world, really gives us a platform from here to be successful in the future. So globalization is one important ingredient in what we think our company will need for success in the future. As you can see, and this is really lit up where you see the green, we have physical presence and employees in all these locations. We have a company that actually is involved in an electrowinning business in Australia. They're housed there. We've talked about our part interest in a Japanese company. There's a De Nora location in India. We have a very large facility that has just been constructed over the last 4 years in China. And that's in Suzhou, China, and an important part of our future. We have two locations in Europe, one in Germany, which was formerly the Heraeus Group, and of course, one in Italy, which is where our corporate headquarters exist. We also have a location in Brazil to serve the South American market, and of course, we have our location here in Northeast Ohio that serves the United States. So our idea on the future is we want to be where our markets are. We want to sell, we want to manufacture, and we want to service in both the local markets if we can and in the local language if we can. So I spoke a minute ago about what is this technology, and not being a technologist, I tried to ask our guys to come up with the simplest way to describe this. And the simplest way I know is we really participate via a simple battery. Our primary product that we serve our market with is this electrode right here called the anode. We sell those, we manufacture them here at our plant in Chardon. We coat here and we ship here. The anode is critical, obviously, to success inside the battery or inside the cell, as we like to call it. We also have some interest in the cathode side. Not always can we participate in that, but our instances, and in particularly in our newer businesses, we're able to participate in that. So this is a pretty simple approach to a really complex product, to be very honest with you. As you can see, we manufacture these dimensionally stable anodes at our plant, and we use large sheets of titanium, which is a metal that is resistant to corrosion. That's why we use it. It's light. It's used in airplane manufacture. It's easy to handle. Unless you have some really large pieces that we tend to get into from time to time. So this is really the basis of what we do inside that building. We have two business units. Chris mentioned in the intro that I have responsibility for sales worldwide, and we'll get into our structure in a little while, but we are broken up into two specific business units, and both those business units report to me on a worldwide basis. Our CABU business unit is the chloralkali that we talked about a minute ago, chlorine, caustic soda, and also chlorate products, which are used in pulp bleaching. So, for example, all the paper you use, that white bleached paper, that's generally used in our process. We also, in our newer side of our growth, is focused in our De Nora oxygen products. And these are just a few of many applications that we are attempting to penetrate. Some of the more important, though, for us are water treatment, cathodic protection, and surface finishing. And rather than explain those now, we'll get into maybe a little pictorial about what they are and where they're used. Our chlor-alkali business unit, as I said, is the equipment for chlorine and caustic. It's all these kinds of different shapes and sizes that are used in many different applications. There's really three technologies that we supply in this business. There's an old, what they call mercury technology, not used very much any longer in chlor-alkali production. The predominant technology in the United States is diaphragm technology. And I don't think we have a diaphragm anode up there pictured, but that's where we have had most of our success, certainly in the US market. And the third is membrane technology, which is the current technology used. All of these have improved energy usage, have improved efficiency for production, and we've participated with the industry to make these changes. And it's been a staple of our business. It generally has represented about, generally was the largest share of our turnover, and now represents probably just around 50% of what we do today. Where do these go? I don't know how well you can see this, but we have some rather large applications. This one here, I talked about pulp bleaching. That's a plant up in Canada where chlorate is produced for pulp bleaching. This is a large membrane cell production area in Germany. Bayer, they don't just make aspirin, they make chemicals as well. And the last one over there, this is a company, and I'm not sure exactly if this picture is of that company, but there's a small company in Ohio that actually makes bleach. That's the same as Clorox that you might see as an example. And that is in somewhere in mid-Ohio. Most of these facilities, though, the key ingredient here is these are large production type facilities that use our products here. Where do these go? I mentioned a minute ago, probably the most important use of chlorine is disinfection of water. We hear many things. We have a trade association called the Chlorine Institute that will tell you all the good things chlorine does, and it really does do many good things. And the most important, really, is keeping our water safe. And so I think most of the water systems will use this type of disinfection. So that's one area. The other big area is plastics. Chlorine is used in the production of PVC, and that's just simple plastic pipe, toys, all kinds of things of that sort. And in this case, here's some pharmaceuticals that are plastic on the outside. So the products that we kind of start with in our factory here in Ohio, here in Northeast Ohio, end up in making things you see every day. Now, our denox area may be a little bit more familiar when you see where the applications really, really happen. We make unique applications, or I'm sorry, unique products for applications that aren't quite as large as I talked about a minute ago. Some of these are rather small, but needed. And one of our most important is we make a small cell that is used in swimming pools. It's been an important growth business for us for the last 3 to 5 years. Here is another case of this is what we call a leader string, which helps prevent corrosion of pipes, of, for example, natural gas pipes, embedded type piping that you wouldn't want the pipe to break. Our cathodic protection helps prevent that kind of corrosion. So where are these used? Well, here's a couple of interesting examples. This is a bridge deck in Japan that actually has our cathodic protection on. And what that does is it helps prevent the concrete. I think here in Northeast Ohio, we seem to experience potholes. I mean, this is the kind of product that can prevent that. It's a lot more expensive solution than sending all the ODOT guys out on the road to patch up holes, but this is an investment over time, and as we get into the third world, we're seeing a little bit more interest in having that kind of protection and making that kind of investment for the long term. This is in Australia, the Sydney Opera House. For anybody that's ever been to Australia, it's a pretty famous landmark is in Sydney. It is on a waterfront, and we actually protect what holds that thing up. And it's a very important application for us, but one that around the world people recognize. Here's just some road construction on a bridge, no different than you would see on 90 or anywhere else, where we use cathodic protection to help prevent the corrosion that occurs in roads. So that's where our cathodic protection products are used. We have two other applications here. I think I talked a minute ago. This is an example in a picture of our swimming pool chlorinator. Our electrodes are right inside here. And basically what it does is it's inside of the piping, and it continually doses enough chlorine to make the pool obviously be disinfected from algae or anything else. And we've been told it doesn't hurt your eyes or anything of that sort. So it's been a real successful product for us. C-chlor, this is water treatment in large power plants. When power plants are built on the seacoast, they use salt water, and we disinfect and ensure that the cooling water in cooling towers at power plants is kept clean so that there's no plug-ups or any problems in a power plant. It's a rather large application and important one for us. So that's the commercial on our products. They asked me to talk a little bit about the challenges of integration. And the best way I could describe this was, if you're an American, this is football. If you're a European, this is football. Same word, different meaning. And I think one of the challenges we've had with cultural integration is both sides think they're right. And how to overcome that's been a challenge for us. When De Nora acquired us in 2005, all of the sales that we did here in Northeast Ohio, we did have small locations in other parts of the world, but they were small. One, two-man offices. And most of our sales were focused here in North America. It was staffed primarily with Americans, whether it be here or overseas. And we practiced typical American processes. Highly efficient, results-oriented, profit-driven. ELTECH was a management-run company. The previous owner was an investor more than a participant in the business and hired the management to run his company and provide results, and that's what we did. De Nora was a family-owned company, and as we will find out, that becomes very different in your management approach. And as I mentioned a minute ago, De Nora had a network of companies all around the world, where ELTECH had a single location here in the United States. So this was where we started. And we had to integrate. So what were the issues with integration? Well, the very first issue is trust. And that is probably the most important of all, although communication is a close second. And what we found was that there are different levels of trust in different cultures around the world. The US, Germany, Japan are used to multinational companies. They are used to working inside of multinational companies and taking advantage of that. Italy, China, and India are examples of companies or countries that have lower levels of trust. And for that reason, find it very difficult to manage multinationals. So we immediately encountered this issue. The second thing, and probably as important, is communication. The language difference was critical. Most of the colleagues in Italy that we interact with had English capability, very high, but not their mother tongue. It was their second language. And so oftentimes when somebody says football, they mean soccer. When we say football, we mean football. A good example of where languages can say the same things but mean very different things. And so therefore, that became a real impediment to integration. Complicating it, time zones, terribly important. You might need to talk to somebody at 6 o'clock tonight and they may be sleeping. They may want to talk to you at 3 o'clock tomorrow morning and we'd be sleeping. So that time always creates an impediment. The distances, we've done an awful lot of travel in De Nora to interact worldwide. But as you can imagine, with air travel the way it is today, it's not the easiest thing in the world. So that became an impediment to success. IT systems are different. We believe we're a little bit more advanced here in the US. It's generally where IT systems are both grown and innovated. And what we find is, as you go into other parts of the world, they're very technically competent, but sometimes the innovation in some of the countries isn't as quick as it is here in the US. So those are all impediments to integration. Last is the culture. The culture can be an impediment because business culture is different in different parts of the world. What you say to somebody in Japan and what you say to somebody here in the US are very different things. How you act in certain situations here in the US where things might be accepted, they might not be accepted in a place like Japan or Italy. So recognizing those cultures and recognizing the differences in cultures and how to connect is another challenge we had. Some of these cultures contain subcultures that are even more critical to their success, but very foreign to us, and vice versa when them looking at us. So we all, in different parts of the world, have subcultures that make this cultural integration difficult. So where did we go with this? How did we integrate and then try and globalize? Well, one of the things we did in De Nora is create what we call the De Nora Network. A global network was established with functional strategies centralized. So I talked a minute ago, I'm an example of this. We centralized worldwide sales under one single individual, and that was me. I have responsibility for all areas, no matter what you saw up in that map. We set strategy at that level, and then we ask the locals to execute that strategy. So, and there are many counterparts besides me. We have a global operations guy. We have global tech service. So what we had to do is take all these functional areas, set strategy, and then globalize it by bringing it down to the local areas and asking for execution at that phase. A matrix organization was set in place, and that's what I just talked about. And that was created with business units and regional general managers. So it's a real matrix between where you're located and where strategy is set. Pretty challenging, though, I must admit. But the most important thing in a network and matrix strategy that we've put together is teamwork. It becomes the driving force of what we do. So let's talk for a minute about the four stages of team. Team forms. The team then wanders. And you all, certainly the student body here, I understand, are familiar with teams and how to work in teams. So you'll understand, I think, these four stages. The team then finds its way. And finally, the team moves ahead because it's found its way, it's found a focus, and hopefully it's found results. Team formation. What are the issues with team formation? Well, this is an area where the team gets to know each other. They learn about each other's skills. You probably do this in your projects here. You define tasks. Everybody gets together and you say, this is what you do, this is what you do, this is what you do. And you kind of come to hopefully a central idea of how you want to attack problems. Here's an example, and we put this picture. You'll see this in all the pictures I'm going to show you. We have pictures of really collaborating teams. This gentleman runs our Singapore office. This gentleman is our salesman in China. This is a customer, actually, or a distributor, actually. And this is our marketing guy. The one common theme you'll see in all these pictures, I asked the marketing guy to get these pictures, and he's in every one of them. The R&D groups were combined under one manager. Projects were rationalized and combined. Teams worked on problems, and video conferences became the norm. This was kind of the first stage. We have two R&D centers, one here in Fairport Harbor, one in Milan. The idea was to take all that talent, put it together, and leverage it to create more value for the shareholder, and that means create more opportunities for business. So this is one of the first areas that we attempted to stage a team, to form a team. We did it as well in sales. We started with a worldwide sales meeting where we brought everybody in. We created teams, we created work groups, and quite frankly, I think anybody would say, the sales integration was pretty quick and pretty strong. Why? Because we had to. If we didn't have integration at the sales level, if we didn't have team formation and results, we would have all been in trouble. So that became a very important thing. But it's also true in R&D. And we did a very good job, I think, of organizing that too. And it's a good example of success with teams. So formation's important. Team wanders. We've had more than our share of success here. And I mean that in a negative way. I mean, we've had teams wandering in the wrong direction because of cultural differences. What happens is people get together, and maybe this guy's goal is very different than this guy's goal, and it's difficult to get a single focus on what to do. So unrealistic goals can emerge because somebody wants to be the team leader. And when that happens, you tend to rely on one individual. What that means, and maybe you've experienced this, is that the rest of the team members sort of start looking the other way, looking at their cell phone, taking, you know, doing emails, not paying attention to what the idea was. There becomes very little focus on the process because somebody takes the lead and most of the team members figure it's his deal. So little progress is made. This is a tough part of the formation. And we've experienced that with our operations group in particular, where we've had six individual plants operating around the world, doing their own operation, doing what they think is best, and what happens? A team isn't formed. And so our global operations group have really been under pressure to try and get a single strategy. So here's an area where we think our team's wandered a bit, and we are trying desperately to try and get that back into a place where everyone can benefit from the team. So it happens. Finding your way. You notice that the marketing guy again is front and center in all these pictures. But the other thing that really helps finding your way, I don't know if you noticed it in the last picture, we always seem to be around a table drinking wine or beer. That's generally what happens. There's a breakdown. You break down, you become more of a unit. We get to know each other a little bit better. Progress is made because people start to understand that you cannot do things in eight different ways, but eight people have to do things in one way. So under that scenario, ideas start to come out, and good ideas start to come out that you can follow. Communication becomes important, and honest feedback starts. And, you know, I said in jest, sitting around drinking wine, but this kind of team building experience is what gets teams back on track, and that's what we've done. Valued team members are able to speak their mind, speak their differences, and come with a common goal. So we have an example here where business groups at different locations transfer knowledge between each other, whether it be product knowledge, whether it be local experiences, whatever it may be, technical advantages, that makes everybody better. And that's what I think we've been able to do at the business level. So that's important. And then finally, moving ahead. And actually, this was a picture that we used in what we call our annual general meeting. It's our most recent. And it's kind of a state of the company meeting. And everyone was given a CD with this picture on the front of it because the company is committed to the team building approach. And you can see there's a various, there's profit, there's income, there's product, there's people. Everything's involved here. And that's what we strive for. So progress then becomes quicker, more effective, more profitable. We overcome our differences a little quicker. And you know, at the end, you find success if you can have a team operating in this fashion. So we're still trying hard to achieve complete success in the area of teams. I think we've had a lot of progress. I think we still have a ways to go. But it's very similar to the kinds of things I think you're doing in team building in your curriculum here. So just another quick couple of things on us. We have a lot of teamwork here in Northeast Ohio that I think it's important to tell you about, both from a community service and a commitment to our employees. We work with the community. We're a big supporter of United Way. We have people serving on committees. We have annual campaigns. We participate in Days of Caring, which allows our employees to go into the community and assist maybe somebody that's a little underprivileged or an older person that needs some help. We really promote this idea, and we're a big supporter of the United Way. Boy Scouts of America, and these are just a couple of examples of what we do. One of our business unit managers serves on the board of directors. We have several other people, one of them here tonight, that works in some of the activities for fundraising in the organization. So that's an example. We participate in Chardon Rotary and their fundraising, Board of Education. There's a number of things we do. I think the importance is a company is not only there to make money, they're there to be part of the community too, and we like to consider ourselves a pretty good citizen. We also have a pretty strong commitment to our employees. Safety is important. We have a safety incentive program in our plant. We're very, very conscious of safety, both in our Fairport Harbor, our Chardon office, and our Chardon plant. It's important because if people are hurt, they can't work, and that doesn't do any of us any good. And we encourage that at home as well. We send newsletters, and so it's an important part of what we do. We train our employees. We do have a program with the Weatherhead School at Case, and we have quite a few of our employees that get continuing education, enhance their education. We feel this kind of education and training helps them be better employees for us. Started a wellness program. We want people to be healthy, and we want our medical costs to go down. So this is really a new endeavor for us, but something that we think is important, and we think it's a cutting edge way to deal with the higher cost of medical care today. We usually do once a year annual state of the company, state of the union they call it. For us, we do that annually, where we get all our employees in one place and we tell them how we're doing, what we're doing, and what we expect to do in the future. We have a quarterly newsletter which tells everybody about what we're doing. And we recognize our employees with service awards. Longevity is important to us. Experience is important to us. New ideas are too, but we like to recognize service and that long service that we've been very blessed to have. And in turn, this is what you get. We have committed employees. We have many people who have been with our company for many years. You know, as Chris said, I'm 31. There's a load of people in the 30s. There's a load of people, you know, I have 30 people plus 30 when you look at the total population. It's quite a testament to what we do. So we're very proud of this, and hopefully looking forward to more of that in the future. Quickly about me, my path, you can read, they've already told about the education. I started, I had a financial background. I started in inventory control many years ago. I ran accounting for ELTECH at one point. Had the opportunity to branch out when I was in Houston into operations and other parts of administration, and then got involved in business development, which allowed me to get involved with pretty significant business management. I've also had management responsibility for R&D. I certainly am not an R&D guy, but I did have the opportunity to manage that. So it's been, I've really had a great opportunity with the company to serve in many different roles, which has just given me the real opportunity for exposure in virtually everywhere. They want to know factors contributing to success. I would say, and this is something, most of you are young and you can think about this going in, don't limit yourself. Be open to rotation, diversification. Don't get stuck into one thing. Second thing I'd say, and I know this is not number one in Northeast Ohio, but be open to relocation. Companies provide opportunities if you're willing to relocate. Doesn't mean you're relocating for the rest of your life. Just means you are relocating for a particular function. And it's quite an experience, quite an experience that I think you would enjoy and really expand yourself. Be open to changing roles in your career. Don't get stuck into doing one thing. And I think as time's gone on, young people have the opportunity to move on a pretty regular basis. So I don't think that's something that you wouldn't be open to. Be open to travel in other cultures. I mean, I've had the opportunity to travel the world with this company, meet all kinds of people in all kinds of cultures. And if you ask me, the one thing that I really love, I hate to travel, but when I get there, I love doing business around the world. It's a terrific experience and it's a terrific opportunity. Be open to risks, though. You're going to take some risks when you take jobs, maybe in situations that aren't very comfortable. And that's something that we all have to weigh individually, but it's one I'd tell you to be open to. And last, none of this happens without the support of your family. I have my wife's in the front row, and she's been by my side and supportive the whole time. And without that, I don't think you can be successful. So that's it. It's the one regret I have. As Americans, there's a tendency for us to speak, obviously, the world language is business, but the ability to speak more languages is so important to success, in my opinion. I'll give you an example. I know a good friend of mine works in Holland, and his kids can speak 5 different languages. And no matter where he goes, obviously one of them is English, but no matter where he goes, this kid can speak. And most of the colleagues in Italy, I have to admit, are obviously fluent in Italian, fluent in English. So I would say that's a critical thing and you should do it. I wished I had. I regret I didn't do it. You know, one of the company has taken the approach that it will work in each foreign location under the norms of that location. So what we do here in the States isn't necessarily translated. I'm sure there's some things that we do here that other parts of the world would like to model. But for example, I'll give you a perfect example, is in China, you know, safety is not the biggest thing in the world. It will be, but it isn't today. So they don't necessarily practice in other parts of the world, nor does the company impose it either, unless it's something that, now safety for us, and this is where our global operations has to, as it integrates, that's the kind of thing. I think that would be something we would rally around the world. But some of the other things we talked about are probably more normal here in the U.S. than they are anywhere else. Products may not be the word, it's applications of what we do. And I think there's loads of people that say that there's loads of applications that we're not taking advantage of. There are some. I mean, some of the ones I didn't even talk about. I mean, we make coatings for wheels on cars, bumpers, wheels, chrome plating. We're in that business. We're in circuit board manufacture in some respects. But there's lots of other things. There's other parts of water treatment that we're not in. There's loads of electrochemical processes that we probably don't participate in. And where they're served is by local companies that may be at a pretty low level. We're a pretty worldwide company that serves all these markets, but we're finding that in other parts of the world, our competition, I've always said this, it's kind of like Iraq. The competition are militias. They're small people, like in China or Brazil or India, that work cheap, and that's something we're going to have to fight as time goes on. And you guys will have to fight it a lot longer than I will, believe me. I think it's a real challenge for young Americans on how we're going to compete with Chinese and Indians. So. In the local area, our collaborative companies would be ones that are manufacturers of metal. They may do fabrication of metal. They may do local type supply that isn't necessarily worldwide in nature. We work. There's a company. Actually, we sell anodes, and one of our customers here in Northeast Ohio is an astrobuilder called ELTECH. So that's somebody that we serve.
Some chemical products?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Technology for chemical products. Wow, that's a great question. I should know off the top of my head, but I don't. It's a tough answer, and I'll tell you why. We sell direct in one of our businesses. We sell through distribution networks in other. So we don't necessarily have salesmen in every application we sell. We have guys that manage distribution networks that will be able to distribute worldwide. So we maybe have, if I add it all up, maybe 30, 35 worldwide, somewhere in that range. They shouldn't be, but I'm not going to sit here and say they aren't. I mean, we're in the process right now of, well, our goal would be worldwide quality identical. That's our goal. I can't tell you that we're doing that today everywhere. We have higher quality here, and maybe in the developed countries where we're trying to establish higher quality in places like China and India. But it's tough. It's tough. Well, the idea is not to accept lower quality anywhere. So our focus managerially is to make sure that every plant is up to, let's say, U.S. European standards. And that's, I would say our Brazil plant is one that has fairly high quality. But we've experienced some trouble in China, like a lot of people have, quite honestly. It's going to take some time. Unfortunately, in the early stages, the competition's quality is not very good. So there's almost an acceptance of poor quality in those markets. That's going to change. And what our goal is to be in front of that. Make sure that our plants, no matter where they are in the world, give us the exact same quality no matter where we make it. And that gives us a lot of flexibility manufacturing-wise, too. So it's a real challenge. It's a real challenge for us. Because there's an art to what we do. Okay. Pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank McGorty.